Our school, the Lawrence School Sana'a, aims to produce a well-rounded, self-confident, positive young person with the following attributes: an inquiring and fearless mind, respectful of others' viewpoints, believes in the values of social justice and equality, leadership skills across the spectrum, social, political, commercial, and cultural, and the ability to stand for others and self. Now, I believe these are the prerequisites of a successful person in the 21st century. And definitely, I am in line with our school's vision, and definitely I shall build on our great traditions and promote 21st century skills so that Sanarians who go out of our portals are an asset to society and will do well in whichever field they take part in.
Thank you so much. Himit, being one of the oldest schools in Asia, there are many traditions and a long history that we need to take into consideration. How do you think you will balance your vision with the mission of the school?
Ms. Praneet, that's a lovely question, because I'm very much in love with our 173 years of heritage and history. It's a glorious heritage. And it is this very lineage, which is a very rich and glorious lineage, that we must take forward. And as regards the mission of school, I would say that the most important thing here is to have an accomplished and a dedicated faculty. We are working on that. Every school can improve. And definitely, going forward, we will put a lot of emphasis on teaching and learning. And, you know, in this facilitated virtual learning program, which General Gulpreet spoke about right in the beginning, we have done just that, because our teachers have been able to learn, to unlearn, and then to relearn, also upskill themselves. But all this is basically going in favor of the all-round development of students. And that is something which I think a school like, I must say, I'm very impressed. I've gone through the master plan. I'm very impressed by it, because with our heritage, as we go forward, we will definitely have state-of-the-art facilities for our students and our community. And definitely, we are investing in many digital initiatives. And very soon, I would say, the campus will have secure Wi-Fi, which is world-class by the time the kids come back. And also, something which I'm very proud about, we are a green campus, and we have schemes, we have projects which will make it sustainable as we go forward. So I would say, about the mission of the school, in short, we have a great tradition, and we are building on that day by day, and the future is brilliant. And what I'm happiest about is, it's sustainable. The students who pass out from here, both boys and girls, young, I would say, gentlemen and ladies, would be principled. And whatever they do will be built on a strong foundation of merit and competence.
Mr. Dhillon, Sanar is going to be celebrating its 175th founders in the year 2022. Can you shed some light on what is being planned for this founders?
Definitely. About this, I'll start with what we plan to do on the campus by the 175th founders. There is a wonderful renovation as well as extension of the girls' dormitory, which is very important. And Mrs. Nader has been very kind to help us with that. She's been very generous. So that is a wonderful project to look forward to. Then the swimming pool is getting renovated, which again, I think is very important, because Sana'a has a very strong tradition of swimming. Ms. Praneet, of course, yes, you were national champion, and of course, your brother as well. And then, you see, our staff is very important. So as we speak, we have architects on campus, and we are planning at least 5 staff accommodations so that we can attract the best talent amongst the teaching fraternity. Also, I'm very happy to share that there's a center for performing arts, which is going to be world-class. And as we speak, there are meetings happening on how to take that forward. And of course, as you know, the core area of a school is teaching and learning. So we have great plans for a teacher's resource center. We will also get a very competent professional to head that. And I would say it will be a center for excellence, not only for our teachers, but we will open that resource to train teachers in our neighboring schools all over Himachal. And I would say up to Chandigarh and Ambala, definitely we would do that. So these are some of the plans which we are thinking of in the near future.
Compliments to you, Mr. Dhillon. This is, sounds like an incredible plan that you have. And I can see that your team and the OS team are working hard to get the master plan off the ground. These improvements, I think, are going to help Sana'a not only be a legacy school, but also a school that provides the surroundings required for the 21st century. With regards to education in particular, most schools have been forced to go online with this whole COVID situation. Can you tell us, I'm not a parent, so I don't know, for us, OS in particular, can you shed some light on what is being done on that front now?
Definitely. I joined on the 20th, and much to my dismay, by the time I came up to school, the kids had already gone back on the 18th. So the first order of business was how to make sure that their education remains protected and is not impacted adversely by the pandemic. So the first thing we did, we brainstormed. So we have a very competent dean of faculties, Mr. Asit Mukherjee. We have heads of faculty. So all of us had a meeting. Of course, we maintained social distancing. We wore masks. But we had a meeting and we said, what do we do next? Now, for our plans to actually fructify and be of use to, I would say, the community and to be kind of to work, we took help from the IT department. Now, we have a very competent head of IT, Mr. Jamwal, himself, with his team. We first brainstormed on a platform. Now, we had to be sure of something that would deliver the program, but safely. So we zeroed in on something called Microsoft Teams, which is working very well. And we first started with upskilling the teachers, training the teachers. But in the interim, we made sure that the children were engaged. So we sent them some work home, as you would, assign holiday homework. And then we were very lucky because all of February, the children were with us, most of February till the 18th of March. So at least one unit of work had been accomplished. And in fact, there was a test due. So the children could actually revise that. We set work, we set tasks, assignments, etc. So the kids did that. In the meantime, we worked on digital platforms and we started off with PowerPoint presentations set to teachers, voiceover using something called a Lynx recorder. Now that worked very well. But we didn't stop there. We went on to asynchronous and synchronous classes. Mm-hmm. Now, right now, the last of the FPLP is going on. At the moment, we are testing. But I'm very happy to report that the synchronous classes worked very well. They were highly interactive. And guess what? Not only academics, but also hobbies, also sports, also well-being was looked into. So we even had the counselors there. So there were webinars. And not only were the webinars, but there was also counseling. Say, if someone needed to talk, for example, you are under lockdown, there's some COVID case in your building, you are, let's say, not happy as a young person, you could actually talk to a counselor. So we had all these things. And then we had surveys as well. And I'm very happy to tell you that 94% of our parents expressed a positive response to the FVLP. And the children were not far behind. 91% of the children were very happy with their online learning. And we got lots of suggestions, which we incorporated. Because, it's like if the children are saying something and the parents are saying something, we must then do something by which we improve what we're offering. So one of the things we did was, for the junior classes, they said they were overwhelmed by too many lessons, too much happening, the load is too much. So on Saturdays, we had no lessons for them. Instead, we had some hobbies and we had some sports for them so that it was like a relaxed day for them. And as we speak, the teachers are busy because they're teaching. Most of it is over now, but they're doing the corrections.
Okay.
So we had a first periodic assessment of learning, which has just got over. So it went very well.
Wow, that sounds really fabulous, Mr. Dhillon. So what is it like? The children are really the heart of school. Without them, what is school like at the moment?
Okay, it's unreal, Praneet. I will not mince any words. At the moment, it's almost like you are in a film without the principal actors because the kids aren't there. But the good thing is we are doing a lot of work on maintaining the campus. So by the time the kids will get here, there'll be a lot of work done. I just want to share a little bit of the work because that's important, especially since the kids are not here and I want the parents to know, I want the OS to know. As we speak, we've completed some 4.6 kilometers of fencing. It's a perimeter fencing, which is a basic wire mesh with some very high grade concertina wire, which is a razor wire on top, very secure. So we've done about 4.6 kilometers of that. And I'm very happy because we must have a safe campus for our community. So 4.6 kilometers of wire fencing has been done. Also, we've put in about 96 CCTV cameras, especially on the perimeter, also in public areas within the campus. And as we speak, we have a NVR, which is in three phases. Each phase has 40 channels, which means at one point, you can actually monitor 120 channels. That is the video recorder. And it's recording for about a month at a time. So I would say that is something very positive for the campus, the safety issues. And as we speak, we had a broadband capacity. Our lease line from BSNL was 30 Mbps. It has been upgraded to 50 Mbps. So as you can see, we had a bit of a storm the other day, but still the line is very stable and a lot of repair, a lot of replacement, especially of the retaining walls, you know, which get puffy in the monsoon and, you know, when it's hot and things.
Yeah.
A lot of work is being done. And also I'm very happy, a lot of toilets as we speak, because see, a loo is very important for kids. So both in the girls department, also in the boys department, as well as for the support staff, for the teaching staff, many toilets have been renovated. And a lot of replacement of GI roofing is taking place because you see, we have to make sure that the leaks are plugged before the monsoon.
Yeah.
So a lot of replacement of that is happening. A lot of painting is happening. And as we speak this morning, we had a meeting in which we had it's called the Estate and Legal Committee. So in the meeting, one of the points that we are going to take forward is to, totally replace the flooring in Birdwood. But by the time the children come back, it'll be a pleasant surprise for them to have a new flooring there.
Great. Great. Looks like you've really been at work while the kids are away. This is a general question that I have, Mr. Dhillon. Our parents around the country are petitioning schools for fee reduction, especially residential schools. Are there truly any differences between operational and administrative costs?
You know, Praneet, that's a very good question. And I'm very lucky because we've done a lot of work on that. We have a finance committee as well.
Mm-hmm.
And they've gone through the figures. We've got the data. As you know, it's a 139-acre campus. It takes a lot of maintenance. And as I speak, our data shows that the overheads are not going down. For example, the maintenance cost, you know, when we have so many kilometers of roads on campus to kind of top up a road with bitumen, it's quite costly. So it's not gone down. Also, no salaries have been cut, especially in view of COVID. We've taken a very compassionate view on that. The board is, as you know, a very enlightened board and very supportive board. So whether a person is contractual or a person is permanent or a daily wager, nothing has been cut. So the salary bill is as would be when the children were there. Also, as I just spoke, the overheads are exactly the same. Where there's a saving definitely is the food, because the kids are not there. So, you know, we make a saving in that. And we recommended, our school management committee has put up a proposal to the board that we must pass on that benefit to our parents. Definitely.
Well, that's wonderful. Yeah,
considering that as a
school. That's wonderful. So there's several questions from parents, children, especially, as well as us OS, regarding Founders 2020. What are your plans for everybody, the batches celebrating their 60th, 50th, 25th reunions, founders in general, OS coming up? What are your plans?
You know, as of this moment, there is a possibility that schools may open come July, August. There's a proposal there. So it's not like a sure thing, but amongst the highest offices, I would say they are considering that, especially in view of July being when the remaining CBSE exams are going to take place. Now, let's assume that the children come back, which I'm sure they will. I'm very hopeful. So is the board, that the kids come back to us. Once they come back, we will have to have protocols in place in which safety is paramount. Now, for that, we are considering getting batches of kids, not the entire population at a time, but let's say the upper six first, and then, you know, working down the ranks. Now, when they come, we will have to have a very strong policy of no visitors, no guests, and no outsiders to keep the community safe. This is important. Now, keeping in view of that, we've spoken about this in the school management committee. Also, we've sent it to the board. The view is that Founders 2020 will be a virtual Founders. So the population on the estate will celebrate. We recognize all our students. We'll actually have founders as it would be. However, no guests, no visitors, and no outsiders. Now, having said that, of course, we have some great batches celebrating their 25th, their 50th, and of course, the 65th. That's very important. And I would say if, especially I would offer the campus to the young people celebrating the 25th. If they would like to come up, say, mid-December after children have gone up, that's definitely an option. They might even enjoy being over there, say, around Christmas, you know, say, after the 15th of December. We have some lovely weather, lovely sunshine. Of course, it's European weather, not so much Indian weather in the Himalayas. But definitely, you know, this campus is there for them. Also for others, another option could be that we actually see this as a zero year, and we have two batches celebrating the following year. But then I would say that the OSS and the batches, they are, you know, the right people to take a call on this. But definitely, I would say that our founders for 2020 will be a little in-house.
Mr. Dillon, that's a huge disappointment for many, but I guess that's something that we all have to live with. Now you...
Sorry, Ms. Preet, to interrupt. Actually, you see, I would like all batches to come up for founders, but in a safe way, okay?
True.
But then, one is the celebration, the other is the AGM of the OSS.
Oh, yes.
I'm afraid even that'll have to be off campus for safety reasons.
Okay, so I guess we need to work on that then.
Right.
So, Mr. Dillon, you hold the unique position of being headmaster as well as an Olsonarian. How do you feel the Olsonarian community can contribute positively to the school? What are the areas that we can collaborate, do things together? Because we are all here to better just the school.
Over here, I just want to share something really wonderful that took place over the last two odd months I've been here. I think it was in the first week that I got a call from General Kulpreet, and he said, what can we do for COVID relief? Make a white paper. He actually said, make a white paper. So I put, not only myself, but some of the senior leadership into a conference room, maintained 1.5 meters of distance, wore a mask very safely. And about three, four of us came up with a few points. We sent it back to General Kulpreet, and General Kulpreet said, work a little more. Well, what came out was the campaign for COVID relief, which the school undertook. Now, I'll just share something with you. The first phase targeted 1,000 kits for 500 families for 30 days. Now, one kit includes ration, and hygiene supplies at a cost of about 1,100. Now, 500 families means that you have helped 2,500 people, and you've done that twice. Wow. So roughly, I would say, thanks to the OS Society asking a question, what can we do? We've actually been able to make a sizable contribution to the community around us. And you see, the wonderful thing is, it is the local administration which is seeing it. It is the people in the villages, and it is the Gram Pradhans and the Panchayats who are acknowledging it. So I think it's very wonderful. Also, I'll just tell you a little bit about what we have in place right now in school. Mm-hmm. We have something called the Estate and Legal Committee. They help us no end, because you see, it's a 139-acre estate. It needs a lot of maintenance.
Yeah.
And usually, headmasters are educators. They don't know so much about engineering. They don't know so much about maintaining an estate. And this is actually like a little town, you know. In Europe, it would be a town. We've got a population of about 3,300 souls that, you know, is dependent on the school directly. Not only the kids. And then there are legal matters. You see, there's litigation. There are all kinds of compliances, state, national, then, you know, the Green Tribunal, all kinds of things. So the legal committee, the ENLC, help us no end in these things. So I think it's a very positive relationship. Also, there's a finance committee which helps us with money, with all kinds of things related to finance. Then there is a school management committee. Of course, that is one of the, you know, committees that is important for any school. And again, a lot of decisions are taken there. Then, as you know, we have FOSS as well. So a lot of fundraising is taking place. And I would say that is a great success story. Now, Praneet, you've asked, how can OS help? I would say, whatever you're good at, whatever you're passionate about, let us know and engage with the children. I would say that.
Well,
if someone is a writer, for example, come up to the hilltop and the kids are here, spend a week. If someone is a poet or an artist or a dancer, come up to school, spend a week with us, and just inspire the kids, I would say. And especially if someone is a techie, for example, now, you know, with COVID and things, we are pushing our digital agenda rapidly.
Yeah.
And help us with that. So any OS who's talented, who's passionate, and of course, all of us love the school, any OS or even friends of the school are welcome to come and help us.
Sounds like a really lovely initiative, Mr. Dillon. So we've had two, bereavements recently. One of the passing of Mr. Mukherjee, one of the passing of Dr. D.C. Gupta. The OS have thought of constituting chairs of excellence for high achieving students. Can you shed some more light on that?
It's actually very sad to lose these stalwarts, because both Mr. Mukherjee and Dr. Gupta were giants. They were larger than life, and I think they were great for the school. Even after they left the school, you know, there was a lot of interaction.
Yeah.
And I remember very fondly a group of old Snarian visited Mr. Mukherjee recently. Now, as we speak, I have an idea. The idea is 21st century skills are very important for our children, the coming generations. Now, interestingly, Mr. Mukherjee represents critical thinking, because his forte was physics. And I would say for a 21st century young person, that would automatically tie in with innovation. Also, Dr. D.C. Gupta was a thespian. He was a great actor. He was a great director. And he was a wonderful writer. I mean, I remember when you were in school, most of the Hindi books that were on the curriculum were written by Dr. D.C. Gupta. So he represents creative thinking. Now, as we speak, there are some ideas. A wonderful idea is a chair for excellence in innovation in memory of Mr. Mukherjee. Also a chair for excellence in languages in memory of Dr. D.C. Gupta. I think these are fantastic ideas.
Lovely. It's a lovely way to keep their memory and legacy going. Absolutely. So this brings me to my last question before we open it out to everybody. Is there any memory that you have of your time in school that defines who you are as a headmaster?
You know, that's a very difficult question to answer, because there's so many. One of the memories is firefighting, and especially, where Squire Hall is, the slopes there. One night there was a terrible fire and we were firefighting. I don't know how we escaped getting roasted alive, but we lived to tell the tale. That's good. Now, that definitely had an impact on myself. Uh-huh. In the UAE, I actually went and, I volunteered for firefighting training. And it's basically 50% of a population in a school, teachers and otherwise, who are, for compliance, you're meant to be trained as a firefighter. But as a head, I volunteered because I said, okay, we fought fires with rakes and things. Let's at least learn how to use a fire extinguisher and, what to do next. True. So I did that. Now, with the kids gone, we've been doing a bit of firefighting training. We've been doing fire drills. And it's very interesting because I see a very high standard of firefighting as we speak. There is a drill that was conducted. Also, the hoses have been checked. And we have upgraded our firefighting systems. As we speak, I am very happy to share that we have had no forest fires this year. I'm very happy about that. And I would say there are two reasons which I kind of have zeroed in on. The first is the perimeter, definitely. We've got the fencing done, good 4.6 kilometers. The first is that. And the second, I would say, is because the training is good, we know what to do. So even if there's a little bit of chance of fire, we are, being proactive about that. So I'm very happy about that. The other thing which I'd like to share is, as a schoolboy, I have some wonderful memories of nature. And I would say that's helped to make me the person I am. Also, the parades that we had, the NCC, the discipline, I think it's helped a lot. But I would say the most endearing part of being in school, the good teachers, of course, but I would say the batchmates, because they will call a spade, no matter what you're doing. If you're doing something which can be improved, they'll tell you like it is, which is great. So that's good. And I would say every experience in school has helped me to make me the person I am. And right now, I'm very, very blessed, I feel, that I have a chance to serve the alma mater. And it's actually very special to be back.
Thank you so much, Dylan. Mr. Dylan, this was really, really wonderful. I'd like to open the floor to questions. The first question we have, folks, I have to say we may not be able to take everybody's question because of time constraints. The first question we have is from a parent from Amritsar, Mrs. Rupan Oberoi, whose sons Udevir Oberoi is in upper 5 and Zoravar Oberoi going to upper 6. Vikas, could you get...
Rupan is unmuted.
Yeah,
yes.
Perfect.
So it's wonderful to hear you for the first time, and my elder son is also listening to you right now. So my question to you is that, can we call online teaching as artificially induced normalcy in a situation where fear is paramount and middle-class families are still struggling with technology? Teachers are speeding up assignments and syllabi in the so-called world of inclusive education. So my question is this system so flexible in reality that all levels of students can adapt to it? Aren't we not leaving behind a large segment of students?
Ma'am, that's a lovely question. And I first want to congratulate you on the question. Also, I want to just offer my best wishes to the young men and the family. Now, I've gone very deep into this, we've got this facilitated virtual learning program. I've gone very deep into this. You are right about what you're saying. It is a frightening new world. And see, what is really frightening is there was something called the digital divide around 20 years back. Around 10 years back, it kind of exacerbated and it became critical. Right now, I would say it is frightening, because if you happen to be on the wrong side of the digital divide, whether it's lack of technology or lack of resources, whatever it is, let's say your parents can't afford a computer or a smartphone, then you're lost. Okay, but the good thing is, I would say in our community, we are on the right side of the divide. And as I speak, I've spoken to at least 20 or 25 brother principals and sister principals. What I can share is, even in the best of schools, even in the best Indian public schools, all schools have not managed to get on the right side of digital education. Okay. And I'm being very candid. I'm being very frank. And this is real-time data that I'm sharing with you. Now, when we looked at our school, we first feared that we would have less instructional days. Now, when we looked at days, we saw in a normal term that ended in June for the children, there would be about 42 days post the 18th of March of instruction. Now, I'm saying this because there are SOPs, as you know, there also are hikes and camps. So, you know, of course, that's educational as well, but not academics per se. Now, instead of the 42 days, we actually have 45 days. Now, has there been a loss in instructional time? No, there's been a gain. Now, the other side was, if the teachers go too fast or do too much online, it's possible that by August or September, our syllabus will be over. Okay, so we've actually slowed it down. And another thing I would like to share is that all teachers were able to complete the syllabus according to their annual plan of work in time, also to get time for revision. And the best thing is that our teachers are ready, even our heads of faculty are ready to take more time if someone needs help, for example, extra classes, they are offered. As we speak, for lower six, we are still having classes, especially the children. Some four children, you know, joined us recently. So four children who joined recently, there's still classes. Also, we went very deep into the pace of classes. What I can share with you is that the pace of the online classes was exactly the pace required to complete the syllabus for the term. So we've not done extra. We've not rushed. And another interesting thing is that we had a periodic assessment, but we got time for revision before the assessment. So thank you for your question. And we are here. If Uday or Zurawar need any help, please write in to us. We are here to help.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
The next question is from Sunamika Brar, Chandigarh batch of 1995.
Yes, hello. Sir, good evening. Good evening to everyone. Since it's my batch's 25th anniversary this year, you already answered the question in the beginning of the webinar. And you gave us two options. One is mid-December could be a possibility. And the second option is next year. So basically now my question is that since I'm the batch coordinator, the feedback I've got from my batchmates living overseas is that they would be hesitant to travel unless there would be a vaccine in place for COVID. We don't know what's going to happen in December, what the quarantine laws would be. So that's my first question. And the second is that would the school be able to accommodate four batches next year?
That's a lovely question. I completely agree that only if it's kind of imperative to travel and safe should travel be undertaken, especially between countries. And I completely understand that. Now, let's say we do it next year. I would say that 2/25 would get a little, I won't say difficult. It will just get, you know, for example, chapel. If you look at chapel, it has a limited capacity, right? So possibly another option could be that we declare this a zero year and we start with your batch next year and take it forward, right? But I would say the right people would be people like yourself, who are batch coordinators and the OS society. And what I want every OS to know is, especially someone who's celebrating something like their 25th or their 50th or their 65th, the school is here for you. So tell us what to do and we'll be happy to help.
Namika,
thank you.
I can button here and say that we'll be in touch with all the batch coordinators who are doing the 25th, 50th and 60th. And we will take your views into consideration before we come to a final conclusion. As per the headmaster, like you said, it'll be difficult for us to go up to start. So we'll take it forward. Let's see how best we can accommodate you.
Great. Thank you so much. I guess it's a one day at a time situation. I don't think any of us can predict what's going to happen in the future. So thank you so much for answering my question.
Thank you, Ms. Brown. Thank you.
The next question we have is from Malini Kumar.
Hi.
Good evening, Malini.
Good evening. You know, the students have just finished their tests last week using the FVLP online model. I'm just very curious to know how exactly did they adapt to being assessed online? Because, you know, it's having been in Sana'a, and you know, having children in class 10 myself, the whole thing of writing an exam in a short span of time, how did they adapt to this online thing? How did it work in real terms?
Malini, that's a lovely question. Now, we put in a few ideas from the International Baccalaureate. We put in a lot of best practices into this. And internally, we brainstormed. Now, the foundation of this was academic honesty, being true to yourself. And the idea was not to see what the kids don't know. The idea was to just find out what they know. And it was basically an assessment for learning so that we know what they know. And when we teach them next, we can kind of make use of that data so that they learn better. Now, I want to thank every parent who's hearing, even those who are not tuned in, not hearing, please convey the sincere gratitude of the school for your role in this. Because what we did is, we sent the papers half an hour in advance to the parents so that the parents would have them. And we requested every parent to please help us in order to make sure that everything was done in an honest way and in a very transparent way. Of course, teachers also requested every student to have the cameras on so that a teacher could also kind of know what was happening. Now, when the children finished writing their papers, we requested the parents to upload the papers back to us so that we could go through them. This is what happened.
So
it went off very successfully.
Will this be this online mode of assessment? Do you think this will be going forward? This will be done more frequently? Now?
At least during COVID, definitely. But I would say even in the best of schools all over the world, they are actually thinking of, you know, having 70% of all teaching and learning online. The UAE is doing that. UK is doing that. France is going to do that. And I believe even in the US, there are some very robust practices in which they are going to encourage online learning and especially assessment.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, Praneet, next question.
Yeah.
Have we lost Praneet?
I'm just taking that.
Yeah. She's collecting all the questions. So any other, since Praneet is lost,
right,
anybody other questions?
Right, just put your, okay. I received a question from a parent. Just a second. The parent, this is Anil Panchar. He's an OS 88 and a parent. And he wants to learn, have we lost any learning time as the FVLP started in April? And how do we plan to cover, whatever time lost?
Anil, that's a lovely question. And first, I must start with congratulating you on the flying. You're doing sterling service. You're helping lots of people. So thank you for that. Now, in short, hi, Anil, how are you?
Absolutely.
In short, good to see you. Is that brother?
Yeah, that's my brother.
Just congratulate your brother, please, because he's a hero.
Thank you very much.
And Anil, to answer the question very briefly, we were actually very concerned that we would have lost real-time teaching. When we did an analysis on actual time versus, you know, say how much time we would be teaching in a term versus the FVLP, we got to know that we actually had 3 days extra, not counting the testing. So we've actually gained about 3 days. So as a, you know, when we got to know that we have gained time, we actually slowed down the pace of lessons, had more revision, made it more interactive. So I think the quality went up. And in terms of the syllabus, we've actually managed to not only cover the syllabus, but also do a substantial amount of revision and testing.
Thank you very much, Dr. Khan. It was lovely to interact with you, sir.
Same here.
The next question we have is from Pooja Bedi. Vikas, can you get Pooja on?
Yes, I'm doing it.
Batchmate of Himat?
Absolutely.
Yes. Pooja?
I'm doing that. She has to unmute herself. Pooja Bedi has to unmute herself.
Pooja?
Unmute yourself.
Oh, hi. Hi, Himat.
Hi, Pooja. How are you?
I'm so good. Everyone.
Hi, Manik.
Hi.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
Lovely home in Goa. I think it's Bard Days, right?
Sorry?
It's Bard Days in Goa. Are you in Bard Days?
Absolutely.
Yes, we are.
Great.
I think a lot of very important points have been covered here, and it's wonderful to hear about the fact that we have not lost school days, about the incredible work that's being done. I'm a part of the FOSS committee, so we're very actively involved in what's happening and what's coming up next. And Himat, you're doing a fantastic job. Unfortunately, I don't think I should ask questions because I'm his batchmate. And the only questions that are currently coming on our group are to ask him questions like, what about the brick wall in the art room? When are you going to confess? And stuff.
What happened to the wall in the art room? It's secure. It's very safe now. And there's a lot of artwork which is there in the art room. I've gone and seen it the other day. And I used to enjoy doing a bit of art there as well, a bit of watercolors, the hillsides.
Absolutely. No, good to know, Himat. You're doing a fantastic job. Happy to be in the chat. Happy
yes,
to
the ball is secure.
All right. We're just very sad that there's been a camera put behind the art room as well.
We'll have to check that out. I don't know.
It's there.
I think it's... I told you there are about 96 cameras that have been put. I'm sure it's for safety. It'll make the campus safer.
Sorry, just a reverent sanat talk. We all listen. Yes. I always know what memories the art room holds for all of us. So.
Mr. Bhale Rao, I remember him very well, and Mr. Madhusudan.
Absolutely. All right, well, carry on with the questions, Praneet. And Praneet, you're doing a fantastic job moderating that.
Thank you, Pooja. And I think with that, we're going to have to call it a day, folks. We're running out of time, and I'd like to hand it back to General Kulpri to give the vote of thanks. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, General Kulpri. Thank you very much.
A lovely evening.
In the end, I would like to thank the headmaster, Mr. Himat Singh Dhillon, for having taken out time from his busy schedule and giving us all an insight into his vision for the school and his plans for making the school the best school of all. I'm also grateful to all members of the Executive Committee of the Old Star Indian Society for helping us put this talk together. I would also like to thank all Old Starians and parents for attending this talk. Due to shortage of time, we could not take up all the questions with the headmaster, but I would like to assure you that all individual replies would be sent by mail to all those whose questions could not be asked today. Before I conclude, I would like to inform you that in the next episode, we shall be featuring a walk down memory lane with Mr. Shomi Das, ex-headmaster of the school from 1974 to 1988. He also has the unique distinction of having been the headmaster at Doon, Mio and Sinar. This talk is scheduled on Saturday, 20th June at 7:30 p.m. Details of the link will be shared with you all on the social media. So please save the date for this talk by Mr. Shomi Das. Once again, thank you all very much for your time. We shall now end today's session with the first verse of the school song.
It's the way we have inside our world, the best.
Now, we have 5 minutes for anybody to catch up on Gupshup. So I'll ask the host to unmute. Anybody wants to just Gupshup before we switch off? Till 8:30, we have time before, so another 5 minutes. You can chat with each other. There are about 220 people who had attended. Anybody wants to chat? Go ahead.
Hi, Pooja.
Hello.
Please unmute. Unmute.
So we have allowed everyone. Anybody who wants to get himself unmuted, he can do it.
I see Mr. Mr. Vinay Pandey there. Hello, Mr. Pandey.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening, Mr. Pandey. Good to see you on this.
Good evening, Mr. Pandey. Very good to see you.
Good evening, Mr. Pandey. Nice to hear your voice.
Yeah, you can see my face also. Good
evening, sir. Hi.
Sir. Hi, Amrita.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. How are you, ma'am?
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Great
how are
job,
you?
Emma.
Nice to see you. Hi, Asif.
Good to see you, bro.
And that's a very good looking daughter. Born on the daddy.
Not on the dad, for sure.
Good evening, Mr.
Nice Mara. To see you. Nice to see your hair. Charge. More than the permissible amount, Mr. Pandey.
Mr. Mehra, this is perhaps the first time in 30 years that I have had hair growth of this nature.
It's looking good. It's looking good.
Pandey, try very stubborn and then take a photo. You look like very good, sir. You look
like. Mr. Pandey, that's a really cool chemistry teacher look.
Mr. Pandey, good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening, General.
Hi, Kumkum. Hi, Kumkum.
Hi.
Thank you, Master. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, sir. I would love to hear more about
your and
the tape is available on Facebook.
Thank you, Mr. Pandey. Nice to see you.
Hi, Meeta.
Hi, Vic. How are you?
Very well, very well. Thank you.
I'm on YouTube.
Hi, Vicky. Hi, Raji.
Good to see you, Vinita. Bye. Are you still in the position?
Yes, absolutely. That's why. That's Puji, why I'm wearing the jacket.
Good to see you.
And a Sara jacket.
Good to see everyone.
How are you?
I'm good, sir.
I'll send a message.
Himmat, you've done a terrific job, I must say. Absolutely brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
Very kind.
All the best. All the best. Master.
That's how he's singing.
Well done, Himmat.
Hi.
Ranjit.
Lovely seeing all of you here on this chat and hope to do many of these sessions in the future. Good to see everyone.
That's right. I think we should have a whole load more. I mean, thousands of us there.
Absolutely.
This homeless look is really cool. I must say that everyone's flaunting. It's so interesting.
I had a Zoom get together in the chapel. The service can be held there. All of you guys can join by Zoom.
That's a good idea.
On the particular day. No, you are not one of them by that.
Okay, guys, we haven't had a word from Sapru, who's the like. Sapru, give us an anecdote, quick!
Not on Fridays, only Saturdays.
Oh, this is wonderful. All right, well, bye, everybody. take care. Lots of love. And see you on the chat. There's lots of stuff waiting for you on the chat.
All the best, guys. Be safe.
Bye, everybody.
Bye. Keep safe.
You too.
See you, Ashima.
Yeah, Ashima's looking good.
Thank you. Thank you.
Ashima, I'll see you for tomorrow.
Yes, sir. All ready.
Chalo, okay. We'll meet up tomorrow.
Bye. Absolutely, sir.
Bye.
Look for.
No, Emma, hi. Good seeing you, Amrita. Bye.
See you. Nice seeing you, sir.
Come. We have to chat. I will call you later at night.
Okay. All right.
So I hope you all are attending a non-com. Kumkum, Amrita. All of you will be there for non-com tomorrow.
Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Yeah. We'll be there for non-com. And yes. You said that there's some questions by permission of the chair, because today I couldn't send in any question. I didn't know how to do it. I tried to put it on chat. I was not allowed to. So tomorrow, can you let us know the procedure, how we can...
I think send them send it directly to Kulpreet. That's the easiest.
Just send me whatever questions you have, we'll send you the
answer. So do you need it before the meeting, or do you need it during the meeting, or after the meeting?
Send it to me beforehand if there's anything. Otherwise, you can raise it during the non-com.
No, I mean, I want to do that. I want to know the procedure, because today I didn't know the procedure, how to ask a question. I couldn't ask a question. At least couldn't get into the
today queue. Was a, basically, we had muted everybody because we had about 300.
No, I'm not asking for reasons. Okay, I just want
to... You can ask questions, 30 of us, 35, 40. Anybody can ask any question. There's no... anyway, you can ask me.
For the next meeting, for the next HM, it may be good to just explain the procedure, how to ask.
It was there, the slide was there in the initial portion.
I understand you cannot entertain all the questions, but just so that we know.
Questions were.
I'm just saying for everybody else.
So I said no. Questions are supposed to be sent on WhatsApp to Praneet's number. Before the lecture started.
It was so given on the creative.
On the creative. So people had... we got about 30, 40 questions in that.
Okay. I missed it then. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I missed it. Sorry. And Pankaj, can you please send me the batch coordinators list if you don't mind? Acha. Okay. So that, so that we know about it, we have...
We've run over our time.
Okay, so
after this.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye, guys.
Thank you so much, General. Stay safe. Thank you very much, Pranay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you all, bye, USA, bye. All parents.
All the best. Thank you, Headmaster. All the best.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Have a good evening. Stay safe.
You too, sir. Same to you.